Well, Ian Matthews brings us to Fairport Convention and the final programme in the series, Poverty Rock. A personal view of the electric folk rock music, its influences and its music, and particularly in this final programme, the music of one of its greatest exponents, that is, of course, Fairport Convention, and a group in which Trevor Lucas was deeply involved with for some years. And he starts today's programme where he left off last week, talking about the classic LP, Liege and Leaf, and also reminding us of the two earlier LPs in which Ian Matthews was also involved. And one song in particular he was talking about was Sailor's Life.
On the earlier Fairport records, which we haven't touched on, which were going on at the same time as Eclection, and I would like to talk about because in retrospect they're very important records, on Half Bricking and What We Did on Our Holidays, both have things of in the folk tradition which are marvellous, things like Sailor's Life and She Moved Through the Fair, which are classics in themselves, and from that came Liege and Leaf. And it, at the time it was being made, I think everyone involved with it, and my involvement was just that Sandy was my old lady, and everyone stood up and said, my God, this is where folk music is going and where it can go and what will happen to it. And I think the moving forces behind it were a combination of Swarbrick and Sandy with their folk roots, and Richard Thompson, who is a most intelligent, perceptive man. Tiger, who got bitten by folk music like no one I've ever seen, because he before that had been a Birds fan and had been into the West Coast music, and suddenly he got an attack of galloping folk, which is stuck with him ever since. And I think everyone involved knew that, and around them knew that there was something very new and very special being created. And I think it was one of the most exciting things that I ever witnessed come together, because we were, the Fairport and the Eclection were sort of sharing a country house at the time. They'd be there rehearsing one week, and then we'd hire it and we'd have it the next week, and our paths would cross. And everyone realized that this was a very special time. And I think I'd love to play something from that Liege and Leaf record now.
Did Eclection go on and record any other LPs, or...?
It started to make another album, and at the same point it folded up. It decided, I think, that Liege and Leaf, and at the same time a record came out by a group called The Band, called Music from Big Pink. Mm-hmm. And on myself and Jerry Conway in the Eclection, that was a devastating influence, because I was playing bass in the Eclection. And to hear Rick Danko and Levon Helm play seemed to be something that we'd always been looking for to play and had never found, that particular type of feel and style. It eventually broke up the Eclection because, by the lineup with Polly Palmer and
Gary Boyle,
it had a very strong jazz influence, and that didn't fit into what Jerry and I were sort of aiming at. My feeling for the roots of folk music again, and Jerry, because he was more into more into a more laid back, unextrovert or introverted sort of. I don't mean it's like the Band as such seemed to represent to me everything that, and to Jerry, that it was people who could play who didn't have to prove it. And I think we should play a track from that record right now. Let's play The Wait. Another group around at the same time was growing in a different direction, in more of a jazz vein, was the Pentangle.
How similar would have they been to Eclection, for instance?
Very different. They were an acoustic band, basically, always. And Bert and John and Danny Thompson, who was... And Terry Cox. Now, Terry and Danny were both straight and had very jazz musicians and had very little to do with the folk scene at all. And John and Bert and Jackie McShay. In fact, Sandy gave Pentangle... This is incredible. I was thinking, two lady singers, Sandy gave Pentangle their name. Didn't know what to call them, they were all friends. She said, call yourselves Pentangle. It's very hard to get across in a program like this. The type of personalities that are about and that were about the musicians. You see people playing on stage and hear them on record. You don't really get to know the people. And the thing that makes artists like that so great, and Danny Thompson is a magnificent player, is their great sense of humour. The thing that makes them... People think they're crazy and mad at times.
But it must also be the thing that makes them spark off each other.
Makes one another great. And helps, yeah, the whole thing is like that. Mm. But the Pentangle, I think, were a great band. There was never any rivalry between the Pentangle and Fairport or the Eclection, because they were very different types of groups, and their paths didn't cross really at all. They were great friends.
Mm.
Yeah. Pentangle made some very exciting records. They treated folk music in a jazz sort of form, which was exactly the reverse of what Fairport were doing. They were treating folk music in a rock and roll form.
So neither was a contradiction of principles, beliefs, or anything else?
Not at all. Mm. No. I mean... I've often thought how interesting it would have been if Bert Jantz had been involved with Fairport instead of Pentangle.
Mm.
What would have happened there? Because sometimes, well, now a little I feel that the Pentangle lost itself a bit. It was a shame. After they'd finished Legion Leaf, it was such an enormous step to have taken, and I don't think anyone was really aware of how big, what an effect it was going to have on the music scene in England and on folk music in general. When they were doing it, it was done as a project. Let's do a record of English folk music, and then we'll get back to doing our sort of our West Coast thing and writing our own songs and stuff like that. After the record was made and created such a sensation, some of the band wanted to continue doing that. For instance, Ashley wanted to continue to just do English traditional music. Sandy, on the other hand, felt that she'd like to do some of that, but she'd also like to write her own songs and use them too. There was at that point a parting of the way. Tiger left because he thought that the band would do contemporary songs and wouldn't do all traditional songs, and Sandy left because she felt that she was going to get tied into just doing traditional music. And the Eclection had broken up just because it had come to its time, and Jerry and I were thinking of getting another band together. The Fairport, as it happened, then acquired Dave Pegg as a member. Tiger started a band called Steel Eye Span, and Sandy and I started a band called Fotheringay. and suddenly you had a British folk rock scene. And it just grew like that from that one record. Then there were other bands around who did impersonations or who got onto, I shouldn't say impersonations, that's not true, but they found that style and thought, we can do that too.
Mm. Renaissance would have been...
Renaissance were a little like that, yes, they were definitely in that...
No, there would have been that time, because we're now, 1971.
But I mean, for me, I think everyone has their band that they love. And Fotheringay was certainly that band. The amount of feeling for one another, the love in the band was incredible. The amount of work that was done, the record, in fact, was made before anyone ever performed. Pat Donaldson and Jerry Donahue came as a result of Albert Lee, who plays with Amy Lou Harris now. Albert was going to be in the band, and because of some domestic problems, he had to go to America. So he suggested we get Jerry Donahue, who then suggested Pat Donaldson. And so we had Fotheringay. And I don't think, whatever I do from, you know, from that point on, Fotheringay was still the band that had that, it was a family affair. And I think we should play the track that I love most on the record, I think, is The Sea. The song itself is beautiful. It's about, you know, London lives on the verge of flood all the time, or it has done and still will do until they get the Thames boom, sort of. After Fotheringay broke up, which was a traumatic experience for everyone in the band, I then decided that I'd had enough of playing for a while, and I was speaking to Blackwell, who owned Island Records. He said, what are you going to do? And I said, well, really, I don't want to play and for a while, and what I'd like to do is get involved in recording and producing. And he said, why don't you come along and work for Island Studios for a while and get the feel of how studios operate and that. So I did that for about 2 years. And what it really taught me is there are an incredible amount of fools in the music business. There's a lot of people who produce records who have no idea of what they're doing, a lot of engineers who don't know what it's about. It also taught me that there's nothing like experience for making records.
So you'd really made, though, a definite change for yourself as a young folk singer leaving Australia to go to England, to now working as a house engineer in Island Records after being on the road as a singer and with the bands and what have you. Right. Had you therefore more or less given up singing at this point then?
I don't know whether I'd given up. I'd just stopped. I felt that Fotheringay's breakup was a great disappointment, and I just thought that the best thing for me to do was to keep out of it for a little while. Sandy, in the meantime, had made an album called, her first solo album, which John recorded. That was called The North Star Grassman and the Ravens. It's a classic record. Mm. Well, the next thing that really happened to me after leaving Island Studios was I was talking to Richard Thompson one night after a show that the Fairport had done. They had just released Babbicombe Lee. They'd made also, before that, they'd done Angel Delight, which I think is a magnificent record. The next record I produced, in fact, was Sandy. Sandy's record called Sandy. Now, that had no traditional music on it. but it had some songs that Sandy had written which were very much in the tradition.
Mm, they were.
There was Sweet Rosemary and Jan the Gypsy. And at the same time, Fairport had started to make a record called Rosie. They'd recorded that with a guy called Dave Ray, who was a Canadian guitar player, and a drummer called Tom Farnell. They finished the record and listened back to it in a moment of, and realized that it wasn't the record they wanted to make. At the same time, we'd been working in and out of the same studios. In any case, the Fairport came along one day and heard the mixes of that, and all looked at one another and said, "My God, you know, like, this thing that we've just done, Rosie, is, like, terrible." Said to me, "Why don't you come along and have a listen and let us know what you think of it?" And John Wood and I went along and we had a listen to it round at Swarb's place, and said, "Well, it's terrible." The songs are good. A lot of the playing is terrible. And it seems that Dave Ray is the wrong man for the group. And so is Tom. I mean,
Tom... Had the group lost its direction having done Babbicombe Lee? Was Babbicombe Lee such a momentous thing? Or
I think it was. And they did a tour of America, a long tour of America. And I think there was a lot of strain on the band, a lot of financial strain. And when things are going bad like that financially, there's so few people to turn to and blame. In any case, they asked me if I'd produce Rosie and remake the record. I said, only if we can do it strictly on, you know, on my sort of terms, and I want to bring in the right people. And so we started feeling around. We had Jerry Conway come and play drums. He played drums on Rosie. Everyone rallied round. Richard Thompson came back and played guitar on a few tracks. I went then and saw Dave Mattox and said, "Listen, we're going to get the Fairport really back on its feet again. I've asked Jerry Donahue to come and play. Will you come and play some, you know, do some recording with the band with a view to perhaps, if it all works out, playing with them again?" He agreed to do that, and we talked, and then the band was looking really good shape, and Swarbrick said to me one day, he said, "Listen, you've done so much towards this record, you know, you like part of the band, why don't you join the group?" And it was very hot at the time, as far as Jerry Donahue, who's a wonderful, wonderful guitar player, and Dave Maddox, Dave Pegg and Swarbrick, and I thought to myself, what a lovely group of people to work with as musicians. So I, without almost any hesitation, said yes, I would. I don't think it did my career as a producer any good, but it certainly taught me an awful lot about playing, and it was a great experience. Steel I Span were the other end of the folk rock spectrum, which had developed that way. Fairport were a musician's musician's band. Steel I were very much an audience's band. They did their mama plays, they dressed up, they danced, they did all those sort of things, which Fairport could never find the time to do. They were too busy being clever with their music, you know, and getting off on the musical side of it. The next thing that happened is the Fairport were doing a world tour, and Sandy and I had been passing on the stairs on so many occasions. I'd be just coming back from tour, or she'd be just going on tour when I was coming back, or vice versa. And we thought, well, we'll make it we'll turn it into a family business. And Sandy rejoined the Fairport, and we came out and did a tour. We toured Japan and Australia, New Zealand, and England. And how it really came about is, I think it was, we were starting to make a live recording, and we started in England, and the idea was to finish it in Melbourne, in Sydney, at the Sydney Opera House. Mm-hmm. Sandy, at the end of the show in Melbourne, got up and sang a few songs with the band, which were recorded, And when we listened back to the tracks, everyone was so knocked out that all sounded was lots of, you know, Bono and hello, you know, isn't it nice to have Sandy singing with us and everything. And it just got into it, and she came on the world tour with us. And we didn't have an awful lot of rehearsal, but we recorded the live convention record.
Mm.
And I think Sandy's song record of John the Gun on that is one of her great performances.
Having done the live LP, Fairport then, of course, arrived back in Britain and then recorded Rising for the Moon.
Rising for the Moon, I think, is one of the... It's a classic Fairport record.
It's a very complex record.
Yes, there's some of the best songs on it, and it's actually, I feel that Rising for the Moon is like three separate records.
Mm-hmm.
It's Sandy's material, Swarbs, and my own.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that was an indication at the time. Mattox left halfway through the recording of it. We got Bruce Rollins, who fitted in very well with that particular record.
And had come from a rock music background.
Joe Cocker and the Grease Band.
You can't get more, hey, more rock than that, can you?
How about that? And he was very good for the band because he came in with a different attitude to Dave Mattox. I wouldn't like to draw comparison other than as drummers.
Mm-hmm. Because just different.
They are both different, but both very, very good.
Dave, of course, is now very much working on the session music side.
That's right, he played and as a side musician without belonging to a band. Mm. I don't think he would become part of another band again. Mm.
But played some beautiful drums on some fabulous records.
List
is...
endless.
Endless.
And same with Mattox. The same with Dave Pegg, who's a bass player.
Mm-hmm.
Every second solo artist record you pick up from England in anything like a contemporary folk or a folk vein has usually got Pegg and Mattox on it. Mm-hmm. Or Donahue, or rather Donaldson and Conway.
Mm.
They are the two classic rhythm sections.
And will you mention Donahue, who went on to work with Joan Armour Trading and...
Now playing with Chinny Chan. We'd always said that when there were the six of us, including Maddox and Sandy, if any one member left, that would be the end of it.
Mm.
It happened to be in the middle of a recording, which threw us into a state of confusion, because suddenly we had all sorts of commitments and things, so we got Bruce to play. But at the end of the year, Sandy and I had been away for something like 8 months working, and we just had decided to change our lifestyle.
I'd like to stay in 1976 just a little bit longer, because that was in fact when Sandy recorded and you produced for her the Rendezvous LP, which wasn't to see the light of day for another 12 year. Months.
Nearly, yes. Eight months, in fact.
Mm.
Rendezvous was, I think, Sandy's finest... Well, I don't know, it's hard to say. They're all fine, but I think it was a great statement as a record.
Superb. Mm.
It was a record that flowed very easily to start with. And I think it worked. It was great.
Did you play on that? Or
yes, I played on some of it. I kept out of the rhythm tracks and the basic things, and anything I put on were overdubs, and when there was no pressure on, so I could keep that distance from it.
Mm-hmm.
John and I actually co-produced it, so and. John Wood has always been, if I have a record to do, I'd rather work with him than anyone else, because he's just the best engineer I know. But we had some wonderful people playing on it, and amazing people, Steve Winwood, Richard. It seemed like the whole family was there to perform on the record, and the Fairport and those people, we have always been like a family. I won't lie.
And from Sandy Denny's last LP, Rendezvous, a song perhaps appropriate to close this programme in particular. Written by her, it's called No More Sad Refrains. Unfortunately, there were, because in April of last year, Sandy died, leaving her husband, Trevor Lucas, and a two-year-old daughter. Trevor Lucas returned to Melbourne to his parents' home later in the same year, and that's how he came to spend some time in the ABC FM studios here in Adelaide, talking to us about his own career in folk music and his involvement with electric folk rock, both with Fairport Convention and, of course, with Sandy Denny. And my thanks to him for this series, which I hope you've also enjoyed. Of course, we talked endlessly about all the other bands around, including the Etchingham Steam Band, the Albion Dance Band, the Straubs, and many others. And I suppose, had we been able to, we could have gone on, but in the end, time is always a factor. So perhaps we can get Trevor Lucas to come back another day to present another series.